of you slept in today? Yeah, we had a few people in the last service that thought they were coming to this service. We had one person at the 8 o'clock service who was 10 minutes late at 7 o'clock. She would not admit that she missed the time. She said, I just came early today. But it was good. Hey, if you were tired, I promise you, you're going to wake up in the next few minutes. They have put together a hot little set of numbers to get it started. They're going to end on a little mellow note, but you are going to start out live. I mean, it's going to be lively. You got hearing aids? You might adjust them just a hair because they're going to vibrate a little bit. But this is some good praise worship. All right? So, Tim Kepler, good to have you home one Sunday a month. There is a group of high school kids who come through Clovis every single summer, and we help feed them lunch for about 2 weeks, and they're called World Changers. They come from all over the United States. They're grouped together and go to different parts of the country than they've ever lived in. And they join with other high school kids, and they repair fences, and they paint houses, and they do landscape work in senior citizens' yards that can't do anything like that for themselves anymore. And they want to change the world one activity, one family, one opportunity at a time. Folks, you and I have the privilege to be engaged with someone who doesn't just change landscape and just doesn't change the color of a fence. You and I have the privilege of having a relationship with someone who literally changes eternal destinies. And he wants to use you and me to be part of that world-changing experience, that world-changing opportunity. It hit the world in the very first century in Acts chapter 2 and 3. And the historian said a group of ruffians and fishermen and former tax collectors literally turned the world upside down. Wouldn't it be thrilling to anticipate the idea that maybe in the 23rd century, somebody would look back and write about the 21st century church that, wow, they changed the course not only of America, but they changed the course of the world because of the message of Jesus Christ that they shared. They laid it down. They gave it up. They weren't selfish. They were selfless. You and I have a privilege of being part of something that incredible. The blackout was pretty awesome to watch last night at Bulldog Stadium, but it compares so little, not at all, to the incredible truth out that Jesus Christ wants to bring to all of our lives. It's a privilege to be a part of that. Well, welcome to New Hope Church today. There's no charge for that sermon. That one just kind of came off the cuff, okay? But welcome to New Hope. It's great to have you with us today. There are Vista cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one out. If this is your first time here, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag, and let us know of your presence. We promise we will not beat on your door or bother you with a phone call, but through the mail, we'll send information to you that I hope will be very helpful, and we'll answer most of your questions. And if not, at least I hope it connects you to the right folks who can answer those questions that you have. But thanks for being here. I will give a shout out. Way to go, Bulldogs. All right. I know there were lots from our church who were there last night, and I hope you had a grand time. We got another win, and that's good. And I like my boy Derek Carr, man. He loves the Lord, and he doesn't let one opportunity slip past him to give a kind reflection about his love for Jesus Christ. I'm very grateful to him for that. We got a few of our folks who aren't here today because they're running. They are part of the problem for you trying to get here this morning. But we do have four from our congregation that are running in the marathon today. Our youth pastor, Robert Hutchinson, is running today. Our director for Celebrate Recovery is running today. Let's see here. Pardon me. Yeah, David Schilling is running today. Michelle Schaefer is running today. And then a gal from our 8 o'clock service, Kendra, is running today, but we have another gal from our 8 o'clock service. Her husband was here. He didn't want to go watch her. He wanted to come to church. I think he was going afterwards. But anyway, so we hope that they survive it, and we'll see them next week. There's some new cards in the pew in front of you. Somebody hold one up. We just talked about them last week. Here we go. They look like this. They have that funny picture at the bottom corner. All right. This just talks about something new that's available at New Hope Online. You can do online giving. Something people have been asking for a couple of years. When are we going to get there? Pastor, we've been to another church. They do it. Pastor, we're going to be out of town. How can we give? And so this is just a card that explains how you can go onto the church website and make a gift through online giving. It's just started. Last week we announced it. We've had about three or four contributions come in that way. You don't have to use it. It's just available to you and for others who are asking the question. You can call the church office. Shelby, happy to answer your questions. You can ask Mark Addis. He knows how to answer the questions. John Longstaff can answer the questions. Here's what I ask. Don't ask me. I can't explain it to you, okay? But they can, and that's good, all right? Hi, Jennifer. That's Jennifer Addis. In case you don't know her, she is our children's ministries coordinator. And you're bringing children in. Amazing. All right. Come on in, guys. Have a seat right up there on the first pew. That pew's yours, all right? So a few of them are going to join us for our worship today. Congrats to a couple of couples, Mike and Shalane. I can say this now, Mike and Shalene Jackson. Okay, they are married now. Yesterday, that was exciting stuff. And then a gentleman who's visited our church in the past, some Lucas and Brittany Fantasky, also were married yesterday. Homeless outreach today after this service. Right after this service is over, head over to the Murbach building and join our homeless team for their November outreach. We've been talking about it for over a month now, but they're changing the dates in which they normally go out. Used to be the fourth Sunday of the month. They are now going out on the first Sunday of every month starting today. All right. Christmas dinner tickets are on sale today after the service. You can go out here under the pavilion to buy your tickets for the Christmas banquet, which will be on Friday night, December the 6th at Classic Catering in downtown Clovis. Tickets, I believe, are $25. I've had a few folks in recent weeks say, Tim, what do you do at a Christmas banquet? Let me tell you, first of all, what we do not do. We do not raise funds. This is not a fundraising dinner. Number two, we do not preach. This is not another service. This is a way for us as a church family to kick off the Christmas season together and to enjoy some celebration for you to get acquainted. You will meet some people from the other services that you've never met before, because you'll end up at a table with them. And who knows what best friends you may come up with as a result. So it's a grand time for us just to kick off Christmas joy and celebration and with a time of fellowship together. Next Saturday, the men are putting on the big shoot, all right? We're not having the second Saturday men's breakfast. They will be gathering out at the sheriff's peace officer's firing range. And if you enjoy pistol shooting and want to know more about it, you can go with them. If you are going to go, you need to see Gene Sperling out under the pavilion today. You must see him if you are going to be attending that event next Saturday. Ladies, you are invited to come as well, all right? It is open to you. Several have been the last couple of times. Next Sunday is our Veterans Honor Sunday. We will be honoring the veterans who are present in all three of our services. It is the day before the veterans holiday, and we will be recognizing them in our service. The following day is the Hubbard Barrow Memorial Golf Tournament. And if you would like to add a contribution to the team from New Hope, who will be there, you are not paying for our green fees, but all of the contributions go to the Veterans Hospital for their physical therapy unit. And we have raised, we hope by the end of this year, $200,000 in honor of Hubbard Barrow and the other boys from Buchanan who have given their lives in service to their country. Just write it on the envelope what it's for, Hubbard Barrow or golf tournament next week. Next week is the U-Bake sale. And if you would like to bake something, bring it to the church for any one of the three services. It'll go on a table out there. When people leave the service, they will go out the doors. They'll see what they like on the table. They'll leave a 5 or a 10 or a 20, and they'll take a dessert home with them. And this is a fundraiser for our women's ministries, and this helps with scholarship for women who want to go to either the women's seminars or to the women's retreats or conferences that will be taking place next year. And so it's a way for them to help those who would like to participate but can't. We had one couple that thought it was today. They showed up at the 8 o'clock service with a car filled with dessert things. Are they all gone? Okay, sorry guys, you missed out. So rather than them get stale for next Sunday, we said, well, we'll just set a table up and we'll let folks know somebody messed up. And so anyway, there were a whole lot of desserts out there. There were cheesecakes, and there was rum cake, and there was banana pudding, and yeah, ooh, it's making you hungry now, huh? And yeah, I got three boxes right here. 20 apiece, and you can have either one of these, okay? But anyway, it is next Sunday. But if you would like to bring something, they would like to know about it. The sign-ups are going around. Just put your name, what service you're going to bring, what it is that you're going to bring. And thanks for helping out in those particular areas. Let's see here. I just lost something. Children's Christmas Choir will be rehearsing right after this service over in the bridge on December the 15th, the Sunday before our adult choir presentation. Our kids from elementary age, all right, are going to be doing a Christmas choir. Randy Berger, stand up. He's running sound today, the newest member to our musical staff. He is not only directing our adult choir, but he's also taking on the privilege of leading our children's choir. And they've already had a practice, but they will be practicing again today. It's not too late for you to bring your son or daughter or grandchildren right after this service over in the bridge. Adult Christmas choir practice is Wednesday at 7. And just to kind of whet your appetite, the Christmas presentation this year will not be sung to a background CD. It will be sung to live instrumental orchestra this year. Isn't that exciting? I am stoked. We've never had that around here. So that is going to be great fun. 1040i medical supplies, you see it in the bulletin. If you can help out with those over the next month or so, Lindsay has put that in there, and Lindsay and Katie and I are heading to the Ivory Coast in February, and we will take those supplies for Village Wound Care. If you were here last week and wanted to give a contribution but weren't able, you can still do that today. Just write on the outside of the envelope 1040i, make your check to New Hope, and all of that will be sent to them next week. A couple of prayer requests that are not in your bulletin. One, Dustin Greer. If you were in this service last week, you remember I was talking about Dustin and then he waved his hand over here. I thought he was still in the hospital, but they let him out and he came to church. And he was home for a few days. He had to go back in the hospital on Friday. It wasn't serious, but they needed to take care of some leakage and a tube that was in him. And they need to do surgery. They were going to do it Monday. I got a text from her this morning. They're going to do it today because their schedule is full tomorrow. So he's probably in surgery right about now. So please be remembering to pray for the Greers today. Shelly has some tests on Wednesday, so please remember her. Jim Critchfield, he gets the planting of the radioactive beads, okay, in his liver area this coming week. So please be praying as they do that process. Rachel Thomas's mom has just gone into hospice this weekend. Would appreciate our prayers. From our 8 o'clock service, Gloria Newton fell and broke her left kneecap this week. This happened while she was watching her grandson at halftime at a football game. And then Cherie from our 8 o'clock service also has been diagnosed with macular degeneration, and she will start having injections this coming week, along with Frank Hicks from our church is going through that same process as well. So those are just a few of the updates that we wanted to bring to your attention today. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. And gentlemen, ladies, whomever it might be today, would you please come forward? Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for the privilege of sharing life with you. We are so grateful that you promise to be with us in the adventure of life that we go through every day. You're not there just for the difficult moments. You're not there just for the highlights. But Father, in the presence of your Son and the person of the Holy Spirit, you are with us every moment of every day. You tell us there's no adventure that's unimportant. There is no situation that you are not concerned about. Father, you tell us that you will provide us peace when the situation seems to be filled with chaos. You tell us that you will provide us hope when there seems to be nothing but despair. You tell us that you will offer us strength when we feel like we are so weak we can't even take another step or another breath. You tell us, Father, that you will bring us contentment when it seems like we should want so much. So, Father, thank you for these incredible gifts and blessings that you promise to us and you deliver so consistently to our lives. When we come to a place of abandonment of our own abilities and we come to a place of dependence upon yours, thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing today. We say thanks. In the name of Christ, we surrender all. Amen.
If you...
if you're new here today, this will be a little bit different than what we normally do on a Sunday morning. This is a different kind of sermon. We're wrapping up today, and there kind of be a conclusion next Sunday to the whole series, but we've been engaged for about the last 5.5 to 6 months on a sermon series called The Things the Pastor Hates to Preach About. We've dealt with a variety of subjects that in 30-plus years of preaching I've either ignored, avoided, or only referenced on the rarest of occasions. We've dealt with subjects like marriage and sex and money. We have dealt with hell and end times and the subject of pleasure. In the middle of this whole series, church membership came to my mind, and I'd never preached about it. In fact, I've never said much about church membership in all my years as a pastor. You think that's something I would have pushed, and yet it's almost something that that I played down. And as a result of spending some time in the Word, came to some different conclusions. It's probably where I'd been before. And to be honest, we have had more responsiveness on what I thought was going to be a rather dull and dreary sermon on church membership. I figured we'd get plenty of response on marriage and sex and money. And we had some good, healthy responses. In fact, I will just tell you this. There are three couples getting married because of that sermon series, okay? And that's great news. It's great news. It's exciting. In fact, two of the three are already married as a result of some things that God began to work in their lives in those areas. We can tell you that giving at New Hope has gone up over the last several months. And that's, you know, to God be His praise and glory. And so there have been some impacts in some areas, and I'm grateful. But there's been no response in any of the subjects like the church membership. People said, I didn't know, didn't understand, never knew about it. Gene has been very busy these last few months. I believe we've approved over 30 new members in the last couple of months, and we're not finished. There's still another chunk to go that he's got to process through and work through. And the Saturday before I preached that sermon on church membership, I stopped into Majesty to pick up a book I'd ordered. And while I was in there, I came across a new little book. And we've been talking to you about it for the last couple of months. It's called I Am a Church Member. And you've been able to buy it here. We've had it out on the table in the back. And in fact, if you never got one and after today you say, well, I'd like to read what they're talking about today, there's a box back there. You can. The way we've sold these is their regular price was $12.95 in the store. We got a special New Hope price for $10. If you were a little tight on money and you could only afford five would work. If you were broke, just take one. Now, here's what's been interesting about that. We've sold a lot of books over the years here, lots of things like that. And we've always lost money. But that was okay, because we didn't care. We wanted to get the stuff in your hand. But we made money this time. So from now on, we're going to go 10, 5, or free, okay? Because it really seems to work around here. But anyway, there's still some back there. If after today in our discussion today you said, hey, I wished I would have got it, then please pick one up and read it. It's probably going to be a gift from now on from our church to all new members. That's after this bunch gets through. But anyway, so what we're going to do today is, what I said I would do is this was going to be an interactive sermon. This is kind of low-tech, high-tech interaction here today. I'm going to give all of you my cell phone number right now. If in the previous 2 months you've been reading the book and either it caused a question that you would like to have answered today, or you read something that you had never thought about before and you just thought it was the cat's meow, and you would like to say, hey, this is what really jumped out at me, I liked it. We're going to have a chance to do that chapter by chapter during this morning's sermon, all right? So we'll kind of do chapter 1. You'll have a chance to send a text to my phone. Chapter 2, send a text to my phone. Here's the deal. I'm going to give you the phone number right now, so write it down or get your phone out and get ready to put it in if you think you might want to share something. My phone number is 559-281-0175. Okay, I'm going to say it again. 559-281-0175. Now, you know, hit that button that you need to hit that's going to call me real fast, and then hit end real quick, and then go to your contact list and enter it in your contact. And here's the deal. When we get to this part in the message, don't call my phone. Okay? Text my phone. Okay? And, there it is. Look at that. Oh, wow, we're getting really high tech. All right, in a few minutes, Milo's going to come up here. He's going to sit in the chair, and when we get to that section, he'll be screening the text. And when I say screen the text, if we've already had the question, already had the comment, we won't waste the time to do it again. Or if If you say something vulgar, we won't say it. So anyway, that's what he's going to do. He's just going to be the one to process it and feel them out to us. So we're going to be jumping in right now on this particular subject. We'll be reading out of a passage of Scripture in a moment, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. If you want to turn to your Bibles and find that spot, it'll also be on the screen in a few minutes when we get there. So we're going to jump right in, and we're going to talk about this subject today called church membership. Is there value to it? Is it important? Is it biblical? Okay? There are many folks outside the church that perceive church as being concerned more about buildings and budgets and nickels and noses and piety and pretense than people and real problems. Oh, people are still involved in searching for the meaning of life, but while spirituality is in, the church is out. Many today question the relevance of church, not just the people outside, but a lot of folks inside. The church is seen by many as an institution that puts form before substance and tradition before truth and conformity ahead of creativity, and it seems more concerned about following bylaws and constitutions than it does the direction of Jesus Christ and the leading of the Holy Spirit. Some have been advocating that they need to leave the church in order to save their faith. George Barna, who is the Christian pollster, he's the church's equivalent of Gallup, all right? Gallup in politics, Barna in the church. He has written that large numbers of American Christians are disillusioned with the church. He supports that trend with facts and information, and he's labeled these church dropouts revolutionaries who are on the verge of forcing a decline in the church in the 21st century. Other prominent writers, Christian writers, are tending to agree with Barna. Amazingly, many professing Christians see themselves as part of the universal and invisible church of Christ, but they do not participate in a local, visible fellowship, ecclesia, gathering of people. Others openly discredit the idea of formal membership in a congregation, and I probably was part of that by my acquiescence to not dealing with the issue, not understanding the full value from a biblical perspective. But while many are giving up on the church, Jesus is not. In fact, it's Bill Hybels who drove that point home to me several years ago when he says the church is the only plan God has between now and the time that he comes again to save the world. We are it. The church is the center of God's work. And if we're going to have a healthy relationship with God, we are also going to have a healthy relationship with the church. Paul tells us in Ephesians 5, verse 25, Jesus loved the church and he gave himself for her. The church, on several occasions in both Old and New Testament, is referred to as the bride of Christ. Just like it would be difficult for you to have a healthy relationship with me if you badmouth my wife, it's going to be difficult for you to have a healthy relationship with Christ and disrespect his bride. For that's who the church is. This brings us to the subject. Is the local church necessary? Is it biblical? Let's read the passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 12. Paul writes it like this, and I'll be reading out of the a different Bible translation today. It's called the Holman Study Bible. And it reads it this way. For as the body is one and has many parts, and all the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether we were Jew or Greek, whether we were slave or free, we were all made to drink of the one Spirit. In other words, we all are Christians in the same way, by Jesus Christ. But we all are very different. So the body is not one part, but it's many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I don't belong to the body, in spite of all this, they belong to the body. You can say, I'm not going to join a church, but if you're a Christian, guess what? You're part of the church. You're just the invisible part rather than the visible part. Verse 16, and if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, in spite of this, you still belong to the body. If the whole body were an eye, one big eyeball roaming the world, where would the hearing be? And if the whole were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But now God has placed the parts, each one of them in the body, just as he wanted. And if they were all the same part, where would the body be? Now there are many parts, yet one body. So the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you, nor the head to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, all the more, those parts of the body that seem weaker, they are necessary. So that there would be no division in the body, the members should have the same concern for each other. So if one member suffers, all the members share in the suffering. Do you ever smash your thumb with a hammer? Get it caught in a car door? Every inch of the body hurts. So if one member is honored, the rest of the members should rejoice in the honor. Now you are the body of Christ and individual members of it. I want to look very quickly at the biblical basis of membership and then at the practical provisions of church membership. And we'll do this very quick. The biblical basis of church membership is found from the book of Acts all the way through the rest of the New Testament. In the book of Acts chapter 2 and 3, we are just given a description of a local body of believers who met in an organized way. And they studied the scriptures and they had fellowship together and they celebrated communion with each other and they prayed. And Luke indicated in verse 41 that 3,000 were added to their number in one day. Can you imagine how busy Gene would be if we added 300 in one day? We might have to hire him extra help, all right, to get through the process. But it tells us there were 3,000 and it was their number. They knew who each other were, all right? The biblical basis for membership is seen in the example that we find in the early church. The New Testament assumes that if you became a Christian, if you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you immediately connected with a local group of Christians. The Bible describes this in a variety of ways. In 1 Timothy, it gives some direction about how this local group of believers, he said, if you got some widows in your church and they're struggling, here's how you help them. And they give a procedure for helping the widows in their church. They also tells us in the book of Acts chapter 2 and verse chapter 5 and chapter 16 that there was a list of members and this list grew as people were saved. In fact, when one believer would leave one town and move to another town, the Bible tells us that they would give to them a letter of commendation, a letter of recommendation to give to the next church that they became a part of. And you can find that in Acts chapter 18 and Romans chapter 16 and Colossians chapter 4 and 2 Corinthians chapter 3. There was not only the example, but there is the existence of church government that is presupposed in the letters that we have in the New Testament. You see, most of the letters from the book of Romans to the end of the Bible are letters that were written either to a church or to a pastor of a church. Their duties that are explained, the duties of a pastor and deacons and elders, they presuppose a clearly defined group of members who are under their care. Not only is there the example and the existence of church government, but there is also the exercise of church discipline described. And I thought about leaving this out, but I thought, no, I'm preaching on the things I hate to preach about, so I shouldn't leave anything out. This is what would discourage people from joining a church, is the exercise of church discipline. You see, two of the longest letters in the New Testament were written to the church at Corinth. It was not a good church. They were very immature in their faith. They were very fleshly in their pleasures. They had a stepson sleeping with a stepmom. And I don't mean taking a nap. They had people stealing from each other. They had people taking each other to court and suing each other. How'd you like to go to church where all that's going on every week? And that's what Paul was writing about. And there was one particular person, I've already described a bad situation, that went well beyond all of those things. And Paul laid out for them, here's what you need to do. You need to go to him. If he won't repent, you need to go to him with a few others. If he won't repent, you need to take a larger group. If he won't repent, you need to bring him before the church. If he won't repent, you need to kick him out. I got news for you. I don't want to do all that. But in order to be kicked out of something, what do you have to do? You got to be joined and a part of it. So this exercise of church discipline presupposes it. It kind of lets us know that you join. And just as a family, this is discipline. A parent disciplines a child for what purpose? To restore to a right relationship within the family. The purpose of this kind of church discipline was the purpose of restoring each other in fellowship. Last of all, the exhortation of mutual edification. It is in church where we are to encourage and support one another in our growth. And then there are some practical provisions. Just by being a member of a church, some good thing happens. We get connected. Connectivity takes place. As already mentioned, being part of a local church gives us a forum to practice our one another verses. Serve one another. Love one another. Encourage one another. Edify one another. Share with one another. This is why we do small groups at New Hope, is to help us engage in one another practices. The wedding I talked about yesterday, all right, Shalene and Mike, they just wanted a quiet little wedding. They'd have been fine if it had just been the three of us. But their small group said, oh no, we want to be a part of that. And so their small group, they organized the reception and planned and decorated. And they helped us with the service. And I mean, they connected. They shared their gifts with each other. They connected. It's tough to connect sitting on a pew on a Sunday morning. That's why we attempt to do other things like the events of last Sunday and like a Christmas dinner. And it's why we encourage everybody to get engaged in a small group. Fine. Well, my small group, I don't. Then change groups, because maybe they don't like you either. And that's the problem. Okay? And you get into another small group, then everybody's going to love you. And you're going to, wait a minute. Okay. It's just sometimes. Guys, we are not all the same. We're not all alike. Okay? And there are just going to be times that it just doesn't work. So great, find another group. Nobody should take offense. Nobody should take offense. If they do, then that's their problem. Second of all, we get to exercise responsibility. As already mentioned, being part of a local church gives us a forum to discover and to use our spiritual gifts in ministry. It's another reason we do hope groups. Okay? None of us can do what all of us can do. Jesus loves to work in community. And then there's accountability. And this is terrific in small groups as well. It's tough to be accountable in a service like this. You don't get to know me all that well except for what I'm like up here. And I don't get to know you all that well except that you either smile or snooze during the sermon. And that's about often all I get to know about you. So accountability takes place in small groups. Can I be a Christian without joining believers in a local church? Yes, you can. But it's kind of like being a soldier without an army or a football player without a team. You'll not get very far in fulfilling the purpose and the calling that God has for us. I hope you can understand that when you join a church, you're not joining an organization, but you are committing to partnering with a group of fellow believers in being the church as we celebrate the life of Christ in the world. Vance Havner, a preacher from my father's generation, said it like this: Christians, like snowflakes, are frail, but when they stick together, they can stop traffic. That's exactly what happened in the New Testament times when a bunch of ruffians and former tax collectors and fishermen stuck together. They turned the world upside down. Don't you want your life to count? Don't you want it to be filled with purpose and significance? Don't you want to be at the heart of what God is doing in the world while He's doing it through His church? Plug in to your local church. Make the commitment to join, to be engaged and involved. Besides other believers, you will make a difference in this world, and God will make a difference in and through you as well. This little book talks about what it means to be a church member. It describes how it's biblical, talks about the unity. It addresses some key subjects. And what we're going to do right now, come on up, Milo. We're going to take our last probably 20 minutes here, and we're going to go through the six chapters just very briefly. Each chapter has a theme. I'm going to do a quick two-minute capsule of that theme. During that 2 minutes, if there was a question or a powerful statement that jumped out at you in that chapter, something that you learned, send that text to Milo so he can share it with the rest of us, and then we'll kind of go through each chapter just like that, okay? So this is kind of interaction time, and I see these two girls up here bundled up in a blanket, and I'm roasting, man. Okay. The first chapter is, I am a functional church member. In this chapter, what I really appreciated was the metaphor they used about membership. It's not membership like in a civic organization or a country club. It's the kind of membership given to us in 1 Corinthians 12 that I read to you. It is a place where if I'm functioning and not being dysfunctional, I will love, I will give, I will serve, I will minister, I will be engaged in evangelism, I will study, I will seek to be a blessing to others. I will remember that if one member suffers, then I suffer, and if one rejoices, I rejoice with them. Membership means I am a necessary part of the whole and everyone is important. Membership means we are different, but we still must work together. Membership means everything we say and do is based on the biblical foundation of love. 1 Corinthians 12 is what I read to you. What is the next chapter? 1 Corinthians 13, yeah, follows after 12, good. Sharp group I got here. And that chapter is known as the love chapter. When do you usually hear that passage talked about? At weddings. Do you know that passage has nothing to do with marriage? It's not in the context. It is not, the word is not used. In fact, it's an okay application. But the primary foundation for 1 Corinthians 13 is what we're talking about today. The way the members of a church relate to each other. This was the most corrupt church in the first century. They were divisive and divisive, and Paul addressed it, and he wrote with great eloquence in 1 Corinthians 13 the quality of agape love that should be expressed in the church. And I think we're going to start a new thing at New Hope, and that is before every church business meeting that we do twice a year, we are going to read 1 Corinthians 13 because that's the context. That's the context. Okay, biblical church membership is to be functioning, serve without hesitation, give abundantly, love extremely. This is different than a country club. There you pay your dues so somebody will serve you. Here you give and you serve. That's chapter one, functional church membership. Any questions, thoughts, or observations come in?
Got one.
Look at that, you guys are cooking.
How do we go about encouraging those who may be discouraged for one reason or another with our church so they can become engaged and involved to make a difference?
That's a really good question. Was it yours? No, okay. That is a very good question. I'm open to some suggestions. What would you think is a good... If somebody is discouraged, what can we do to encourage them to become engaged? Yes? That's mini pastor back. You survived the run. Atta boy. Where did you finish?
At the finish line.
What a smart guy. How far back in the pack did you finish?
Just under 2 hours.
Okay, good job. Good job. Attaboy. Here's just the first thing, and you guys can pop in at any moment. So the first thing is, you got to let somebody know. Yeah. Well, but if you're discouraged, you have to let us know, because we don't have a ball, okay? And it's hard for us on staff to necessarily know that. So first of all, you got to tell us, or tell somebody, and let them do something about it. We attempt to provide in on Sunday a list of things, of ways to be engaged. And of course, I'm going to come back to this again and again. I think one way to get engaged on a very, very most significant but small scale is join a small group. Join a small group. Let your small group know, hey, I've been discouraged. I'm joining a small group because I want to connect to some other people. And I'm hoping that maybe together y'all can encourage me. And then when I get better, I'll encourage you. It's part of what that is. But that's a good question. Any other questions? Any other comments on this?
Just a comment. Response, I suppose. Accept them for where they are and mm-hmm. love them.
Accept them from where they are. Love them. Absolutely correct. Because we all come here at different stages. We all come here at different places in life, different points of spiritual growth, different limits of what we know about God's truth and what we know about God's people. And we also have to make sure as a church that we don't think we got it all together. Okay, that you need to know your pastor's not perfect and your staff's not perfect, and in case y'all didn't know, you aren't either. We're all in that same boat of imperfection together. But why am I lying to you? But it's terrific. We when they know that we're not perfect, but we love a God who is and a God who's involved in the process of perfecting us, then it changes. It changes. Second chapter. I am a unifying church member. I will seek to be a source of unity. I know there's no, already got here. There's no perfect pastor, staff, or other members. I will not be a source of gossip, dissension, One of the greatest contributions that I can make, that's each of us is the I here, is to do all that we can in God's power to keep the church in unity for the gospel's sake. That's the key. Why do we pursue unity? For the sake of presenting the gospel. Unity is critical. Ephesians 4, Paul says it this way, verses 1 and 2. Walk worthy of the calling you've received. Walk with humility and gentleness, with patience, accepting one another in love, diligently keeping, listen to that, diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit with the peace that binds us together. Never be a divisive source. Colossians 3:14 says, above all, above what? What's left out? Nothing. So above all, this is, he's telling us, this is more important than anything else. In the life of your church, this is more important. Above all, put on love. The perfect bond of unity. Gossip is not to be tolerated in God's church. Don't be the source of it. Don't spread it. Any of you all as a kid ever spread manure? Same thing. One's just one you spread with your hands. The other one you spread with your lips. But it's the same thing. Rebuke the gossiper. You want to go with me to that person and let's talk about it together? Usually puts a pretty quick stop to it. You see, forgiveness is to be frequently encouraged, fervently offered, and freely received. Church unity is torn apart when members refuse to forgive, when any member is too prideful to grant forgiveness or is too stubborn to ask for it. Each church is made up of imperfect members, staff, and pastors. We all will make some mistakes. We must become a gossip-free zone and a forgiveness-generous church. That's chapter 2. Questions, comments?
Just before you went on, there was one more comment or a question. Do you need to be baptized to be able to join New Hope?
The answer is yes, no. The way it's kind of phrased is you do not have to be a member to, you don't have to be baptized to join the church, but you must be willing to be a candidate for baptism once you've joined the church. Does that make sense? Does that terminology connect? In other words, if you are a Christian, a step of obedience, the first step of obedience that Christ asks of us as a Christian is to be baptized. So if you're willing to want to join the church, you should then be willing to take that step the next time an opportunity is given for baptism to be willing to be baptized. And so you can apply and you can even be approved as long as you would be willing when opportunity presents itself to make that step of obedience and baptism as a member. Now, at New Hope, though I come from a strong Baptist background, we do not insist that people be baptized by immersion in joining New Hope. If you were sprinkled as an adult believer, okay, does that make sense? Okay. In other words, you weren't sprinkled as an infant. Your parents did that to you. That was not done because you became a Christian. And so we call this believer's baptism rather than infant baptism. And if in your believer's baptism you were sprinkled rather than dunked, then that's okay. We're not going to argue. And we have rebaptized folks who thought, no, I want to sell out. All right, I want to get soaking wet. That's okay too. And we have sprinkled on occasions here because that was the best we could do in some circumstances.
There are two. This one is kind of lengthy. So I was judged in my other church by someone who was a friend of mine for 14 years. So this chapter really hit home for me. And I'm now more aware of gossiping and try not to get involved in any part of it. This friend is no longer my friend. I've changed churches. And it drove me away from that. I first thought there was a question in there, but
okay, that's good. I appreciate you sharing that. That has happened to a lot of us at various times. We've been hurt. The folks who have hurt me the deepest in my lifetime have been those who were closest to me. The deepest hurt I've ever experienced in life came from the best friend who taught me how to hunt. We were ordained at the same time. I was ordained to preach. He was ordained as a deacon. And we were both imperfect. And those kind of things happen. And if that were to ever happen, if you were ever to feel judged here, please come get one of the pastoral staff and tell us what's... In church, we can't control what everyone does. Okay? And since we are imperfect, sometimes there's going to somebody may say, I know we've had folks who've been hurt or offended sometimes because of political persuasions. Okay? You know, if you're a Republican, you don't mind making fun of Democrats. And if you're a Democrat, you don't mind making fun of Republicans. But holy mackerel, if you're a Democrat and a Republican makes fun of you, all hell breaks loose. And vice versa, okay? And so sometimes with innocence, people have said those kind of things. And you can't deal with it unless somebody tells you this was hurtful to me or this wasn't good. And then we can sit down together and work through it. And sometimes that's a very healthy and healing thing for us to do. But yeah, it's we hope there's not a spirit of judgmentalism here.
I think me, Pastor, answered this one, but how can we encourage you as pastors in a very lonely yet very important leadership role?
That's coming up in chapter 4, so hold that one just a moment. Okay. In our last service, I don't know if you can back up on those texts.
Yeah.
Do you want find the one on Think. Yeah, the acronym on Think. Here was a great way to deal with gossip. Somebody sent this in.
Okay. What if you were baptized in another church? A Baptist church.
Not a problem. Yeah. Okay. No, it'll make a difference. Presbyterian, Methodist, make a difference. As long as it was believer's baptism.
What if the leadership in the church has a problem with you?
Man, come talk to us.
Yeah.
Yeah, come talk to us. I can't help my looks. Everything else I can kind of work on. That one I'm sort of stuck. That's a problem for me. I don't like it. But no, yeah, come. And if it's with me and you don't feel comfortable coming to me, first go see Gene, okay? And then with Gene, let's get together. And if it's with Gene and you don't feel good going to him directly, come to me, and then together we will go and sit down. But that's the way in which you work through those issues.
Yeah. Okay? And
did you go back to Think yet?
I can get back there, but
yeah.
Let me read
okay.
This one. Should those that break the unity with the church stay with the same church? Yeah.
Well, you're finding Think. I'll talk about that a little bit.
Okay.
Yes, if you've tried everything possible to restore unity, stay in the church till you've tried everything possible. When it's not possible, when you've tried, when you've prayed, and one of two things either occurs. One, they don't follow biblical principles in attempting to resolve it, then by all means leave. Or if after much prayer and conversation, okay, you just feel like that this is this or wherever is no longer a place that God can use you at your very best, then with graciousness leave. Does that make sense? Okay. But you do your very best. I mean, you don't bail out on family. Let me have your kids been perfect? Okay. Have they ever just really ticked you off and you wish you could do what Bill Cosby recommended? Most of you have heard Bill Cosby. Yeah. You can take them out and make another one just like them. But guess what? They're still part of our family. And so what hurts us as staff, as I can tell you, is when folks leave and they just don't ever say a word. When yet they've been engaged and you've been apart and, you know, you've married and buried and baptized and dedicated and you had no idea there was something going on and you find out the back door. Okay, the gossip, because we got to wrap this up.
Regarding gossip, before you say anything, Think, and the acronym is Think. T, is it true? H, is it helpful? I, is it inspiring? N, is it necessary? And K, is it kind?
Yeah, all those are good. One of the key ones that most of us don't think about is it necessary? Is it necessary? In the last service, somebody asked, how do you know if it's gossip? If somebody says, I want to tell you something, but you can't tell anybody.
That's gossip.
All I want you to do is pray about this, okay? I don't want anybody coming to me and saying, hey, did you know so-and-so has this problem, but you can't say anything about it. Tell me, what good is that? Okay? What good is that? You've now placed a burden on me. I know a problem, but I can't do anything about it. Can't address it. Can't deal with it. That's gossip. All right. If you have a chance, read pages 36 through 38 in here. It's the survey of inwardly focused churches. Very interesting. Chapter 4, I'm a church member who prays for church leaders and staff. God bless you when you do. Here's three ways in which you can pray for your staff. Pray for our teaching and our preaching. Okay? That is the most important thing that we do, is to teach and to preach. So please pray for us as we do that. Number two, pray for our families, for our spouses, for our children, and for our parents. you happen to be like me and you have your parents in your church, because they often carry a lot of the load as well. So pray for our families. And I'm going to take just a sidebar here for a moment. Gene and I find ourselves in the past the midline of life, slightly. Okay, we're a little past halftime. All right, a little past halftime. And I can't necessarily tell you that it gets easier, but I can tell you the challenges are different at this stage of life. Okay. I mean, I don't have quite the same energy level I once had. So that part gets a little bit. My memory is not quite as sharp as it used to be. Or maybe it's the fact I just have more facts in my head than I used to. But what I can tell you is right where Robert is right now is the toughest time in ministry life. I can tell you that because I lived through it. Okay? Your life is changing. Your financial structure is changing. The demands on your life are huge. When you've got one in elementary school, one in junior high, and one in high school, that is about as tough as it gets. And then you are engaged in ministry, and you're pouring yourself into 40 to 60 kids on a Monday night, and another 20 to 30 kids on a Wednesday night, and you're engaged in ministry, and ministry, and church, and private, and personal life all flow together. And that season of life, I can tell you from personal experience, is absolutely toughest. So you pray for our families. Last of all, pray for our protection. If you've been around long, you know, I'm not talking about here about my personal protection. That's not a prayer I really like. Keep me safe. Read the book of Acts. Why should I pray for safety? Why should I pray for my personal protection? It's appointed unto me once to die. It may be tomorrow, it may be next week, it may be next year, it might be the next century. Probably not. That was a little funny. Thank you for being awake. But my personal protection, I mean, when you look at how all the apostles died, when you look at how most of the Christians, when I pray for protection, that's not what I'm concerned about. Pray for our protection as pastoral staff from foolish arguments. Drains us. Pray for our protection from unwise choices. And pray for our protection from time wasters. Those things are all distressful. Anything about chapter 4 came out? Anything else?
This is not chapter 4.
Okay, chapter 5. We're going to wrap this up really fast. I'm a church member who wants my family to be healthy church members. If you have young children to teenage years, take an opportunity at least once a week to sit down with your kids and say, let's pray for our pastors. Let's pray for our church. Let's pray for your youth group. Let's pray for the kids in your group. Let's pray for your church. This is their family too. And you create an atmosphere of appreciation, concern, and connectedness when as parents you lead them in praying. You give them an appreciation for church they can't get really in any other place. Anything about chapter 5?
I haven't got anything more, but I do have the one. I'll just read it. How do you get your family member who calls themselves Christian but refuses to attend any church because they think it's political and so forth? The response was, I don't have to go to church to go to heaven. How do you get them to see it differently?
And that's a tough challenge. I want a couple of small suggestions. One, keep that a matter of prayer. Number two, guard your tongue of what you have to say about the church. Okay? Be careful. I want you to be truthful, be careful. Talk about the good things about church. And you got to look for the right moments. I don't need to go to church to go to heaven. That's absolutely correct. The thief on the cross never did, but he died right away. Okay? But so is a relationship with God then just about you going to heaven? Is that all your faith is about? Really? You just invited Christ in your life so you know that you're going to heaven? And that's all this life? You see, folks, for some reason that has become the preeminent thought for most people. When in God's economy, that's the bonus. That's the bonus. What God's primary purpose for sending his son and dying on a cross and being raised from the dead was to do was to get Jesus into us. so that the life I now live in this world, I live in the abiding and abundant presence of Jesus in me. And when I do that, guess what? Not only am I going to heaven, but God will use me and God will use you to bring others with you. And so the idea of a relationship with God, and then at some point you find an open door and begin to say, well, okay, let's, yeah, not everybody's prayer. Give them this book. Buy them the book. Say, okay, you don't want to go, read this and let you and I go to dinner. Take them to Fleming's and say, you know what, I'm going to, and let's, you read the book, I'll take you to Fleming's and we can talk about it.
Hey, the response
and then get their
I'm
response.
I'm a good person and I do good things.
Yeah. You know what? Being a good person and doing good things, there's a lot of people in hell who are good people and who did good things. I don't know how much plainer I can say it. You don't get to heaven by a goodness meter. You get to heaven by one thing and one thing alone. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe he is my personal Savior. I believe that he died on a cross, was buried, rose again 3 days later, and now he wants to come live in my life. I get to heaven not by good deeds. I get to heaven because Jesus Christ gave himself for me. And I love him with all of my heart. Out of that relationship, good deeds will come. But those good deeds come because of the relationship, not in order to have the relationship. You understand the difference? It's like a child trying to please his parents, and his parents say, if you're good, I'll love you. So a kid works hard to try to get the love of his parent. But a good parent will say, I love you no matter what you do. I may not like what you do, but I love you with all my heart. I'll lay my life down for you. And that's what Jesus did for us.
Chapter 4, the lonely leadership. How can we encourage you as pastors?
Robert said, buy us something. No, kidding. Okay. You went above and beyond on a appreciate it. Really, you can pray for us. You can sometimes just call and say, hey, I'm praying. You don't have to say anything more. Just send a text. I prayed for you today. I prayed for you. Man, you have no idea the difference that makes for us at that moment. Be aware of what's going on. When we talk about opportunities in ministry, what we're usually saying is help. I got an opportunity in my ministry. What I'm really saying is I need your help in this ministry. Okay? And if you have the tools, you have the resources, that's a giftedness. Or maybe just God saying, here's where I want you to plug in. But words of encouragement are far more valuable than anything that you can do. Gene, anything else to add to that one? A cigar is not bad either, actually. All of us appreciate that here. Cube, okay. All right. Last of all, I'm a church member that treasures membership of this church. I thank God that I'm a member. Let me wrap it up with this. Was there anything else that came in? Okay, wrap it up. I'm going to let Max Licato give us the final word on this subject today. Max said this. He said, oddly, some people enjoy the shade of the church while refusing to put down roots. God, yes. Church, not so much. They like the benefits, but they resist commitment. The music, the message, the clean conscience, they accept church perks. They date her. They visit her on occasion. They enjoy an occasional rendezvous. They use the church. But commit to her? No, I've got to keep my options open. Got to play the field. Don't want to miss out on a potential opportunity. And Licato said, I propose they've already missed it. You miss the church, you miss God's sanctioned plan for his redemption. For church is the key place to do what we do best to the glory of God. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Church membership is not about a path to heaven. Church membership is about you expressing yourself to as many as possible on not only how to get to heaven, but how to get the God of heaven into them. Help us understand the value of community and commitment. Help us understand the value of connectedness and accountability and responsibility. Help us understand that the church is your bride. It's hard to have a relationship with you and hate the bride. Help us grow in understanding of these matters. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And if you want to know how to join the church, there's a card in the pew in front of you. Put your name on it. Check the thing that says church membership. Hand it to an usher or somebody on the way out, and Gene will be happy to follow up with you in the next several days. God bless you. Have a great day, and can't wait for the new sermon series, The Things the Pastor Loves to Preach About.